we thank you for all of your grace, all of your goodness, all of your mercy, all of your kindness, all of your favor. Father, all of your goodness can be expressed in one word, your grace. Your grace is the sum total of all that you have done for us. And all that you have done for us has been done for us because of Christ, through Christ. Because of the sacrifice that he made, the willingness, hallelujah, even before he even entered into the world, to become a hallowed sin for us, to be the Lamb of God, even before there even was a world. Father, it was because of his kindness and his love, yes, and his mercy, and all that he was willing to forfeit, all that he was willing to lay down, all that he was willing to suffer, all that he was willing to go through, it was because of his sacrifice that he made that brought the blessings upon us and made it possible for us to experience the mercies and the grace that we have today. We know that, hallelujah, that grace and truth came through you. Father, we thank you. You're full of grace. And we give you praise in tonight. Lord, you're concerned. You're touched. You're moved by the feelings, whatever we are going through, whatever pain we feel, whatever crisis that we should go through, whatever problem we have, Lord, you're touched with the feelings of our infirmity. Hallelujah. Lord, you are full of compassion. You are slow to anger, and you are great mercy. Lord, we thank you tonight because we know that we have a God that is concerned about us. We can cast all of our cares upon you. Hallelujah, knowing that you care. You've already gone through every pain, every heartache, every challenge, every conflict that we will ever face, because you have gone through it and experienced it. Lord, you know how to deliver all of us that's going through various kinds of troubles and trials and hardships. Father, we thank you tonight. Glory, hallelujah, for the plan that you have made for us even before there even was a world. Oh God, you were a lamb slain before the foundation of the world. We thank you tonight, Lord, because your grace still is sufficient. Yeah, it's sufficient to meet every need. Lord, you have a grace for every trial, every heartache, every pain, every difficulty. There's a grace. Glory. Lord, you have, your grace is exceeding great. Hallelujah, your grace is great. Hey, the Bible speaks about the riches of your grace. Lord, we thank you today because your grace today is sufficient. And you're able to cause whatever measure we need. Hey, hallelujah, whatever sort of kind of grace we need. Whether saving grace, Lord, we thank you for saving grace. Hallelujah, when we were yet without sin, due time. You died for the ungodly when we were dead in trespasses and sin. You quickened us together with you, and by grace we are saved. That's a gift of God, not of ourselves, lest any man should boast. Lord, we thank you for keeping grace. Oh, God, you're able to keep us from falling. You're able to preserve us faultless before your presence with exceeding great joy. Lord, you can keep us in the midst of hardship, in the midst of adversity. Hey, in the midst of temptation. Hey, there's no temptation that have ever befell us that's not coming to man. We, hallelujah. Father, we know that you can make a way for us to go through that temptation, either for us to go around it, to go under it, to go, hallelujah, through it. Hallelujah. We thank you today for your ministry grace. You're able, God, to give us the ability to share and to handle the word of God and to, hallelujah, articulate the blessings and the mercies and the provisions that you have made for us, so people can be blessed, so people can be saved. Father, we give you praise and the glory tonight. In Jesus' name, we thank you that you're able to meet all of our needs. Hey, according to your riches and glory. All of our needs have already been met. You've already given us everything that pertains unto life and unto godliness. These blessings are already ours. They've been paid for. We've been bought with the price. Hey, Lalamaha. Lord, as we began to step up and claim what's ours and to, yes, stand on the word of God and call the things that be not as though they are. Lord, these things, as we began to rejoice and praise you for the reality of them, oh, for the manifestation of them, hallelujah, you will begin to work behind closed doors. Thank you, Lord, for working your will and the due of your good pleasure in us. We know that you are working right now. Hey, we can't see everything that you're doing. Hey, but we know that you're able to keep us from falling. Hey, you're able to present us faultless before your presence with great joy. Father, tonight we give you praise and we give you the glory now. In Jesus' name, Jesus' name, thank you, Lord, for the victory. For this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. We're standing on the promises of God. All of these promises in you are yea and amen. We give you praise and the glory now in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Glory. We give you praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. All right. Praise the Lord. Just take out your valuables there. We're going to get moving in. Psalms 145, verses 8 and 9. We've been talking a lot about faith and the importance of meditation and focusing on the Word of God so that we can really begin to experience the reality of all of the things that God has promised us. I think all of us remember, and I have a handout, that there are three components of meditation. If you have your little handout, page 14, the three components of meditation. Those that haven't been here recently, I'll give you a copy of what we're talking about. All right, this is a handout that we've been having. Do you have one of these?
I think mine's in the car.
Okay. This is okay, let me see. I don't have another one. All right. The three components of meditation are verbalization, visualization, and internalization. So the thing that we want to understand is the area of our need. Sometimes if we have financial needs, we need to, in order to get our faith established in the area of finances, it will require meditation in the area of prosperity. And if you have a meditation book, the meditation book is full of scriptures pertaining to God's promises to prosper us. Now, I guess the average person said, well, how in the world can you just read a scripture and you just prosper from there? What does the word has to do in order for you to draw from that the motivation, the inspiration, the zeal, the wisdom in order for you to prosper? What does the word has to become to you? It has to become what? Somebody say real? Okay. I guess the first thing, you have to be willing to spend the time. And if we don't have the time to spend, then what do you think will ultimately happen?
Nothing.
Sister, you said what? Nothing. All right. Now, I think that perhaps one of the main reasons why the word hasn't really become alive, or we haven't really began to tap into the provisions, is because probably, I would say, most people do not have time. You know, we just, how many is a busy day? Mm-hmm. See, like every minute of your day is taken some kind of way, right? All right, so if all of our time is taken, then that means that we probably won't have adequate time to what? To get established in the Word, to for the Word to become reality. Now, what you have to do with your schedule, you have to probably revamp your schedule. Okay, one practice that I make in the morning time, okay, let me just give you the illustration. If I don't get up early and walk, I just say, well, I'll do it later today. I'll do it sometimes today. I'll wait until 12, you know, and go to the mall. It'll be, you know, cool there. Of course, 12 o'clock during the summer and fall is kind of warm. So whenever I put it off, procrastinate, and don't make a pattern of it or a habit of it, more than likely, I won't ever get around to it. And sometimes a whole day goes by, I say, man, I didn't even walk. And you can feel it, too, when you start getting older. You can feel it. And it's the same way with the Word of God. You know, in the morning times, you say, well, I'll do some meditation a little later on. I'm going to do this right now. I'm going to watch the news. I'm going to do this. I'm going to watch TV. I'm going to do the other. And before you realize that the whole day is what? Gone. And you really haven't done it. So to me, the best time is real early in the morning. How many can get up at around 4 or 5? Or?
Am I the only one?
Yeah. No, I get up at 5.
Now, how many watch TV late?
Well, I'm watching TV late.
Okay, but the best time really to absorb is when your mind is what, fresh? Mm-hmm. You get up in the morning, and I really suggest if you really having struggles with finances, I think that you ought to really meditate that over and over and over and over and over. If you're having problems with motivation and sharing the word with people, then there's an area that you can do. Okay, suppose you have a problem with sickness. There's a whole area, a whole bunch of scriptures. And it's broken down into areas like God's promises of longevity. God promises that you won't die before your time. Mm-hmm. Now, how do you make that reality and really begin to reap the benefits of that? You have to, what, meditate that. And then you have to get that ingrained into your thinking. And then you begin to think like, you know, I ain't going to die soon. I'm going to live out my days. I'm going to stay right here until I get ready to go. But I'm going to fulfill the call of God on my life. That's the kind of thinking that you really begin to develop when you begin to read scriptures that really point out God's will for you to live your days, all of the fullness of your days. So that's what meditation does. It really gets these scriptures locked into your mentality and subconscious mind, and then you begin to develop the mindset for, you know, meditating the word is not going to cause somebody to come by, you know, every time you have a need and put money in your mailbox. Sometimes God might speak to somebody, but that's not looking for nothing like that on a consistent basis. But creativity comes when you are involved with the Word of God. Creative ideas will begin to form in your mind when you meditate the Word and when you praise the Lord. When you praise the Lord with all of your heart and rejoice, and praise the Lord, amen, and delight yourself in the Lord, God will begin to show you, although you have been reading God's will for you to prosper, then God begins to what? Show you or quicken things that you could, what, do. Sometimes somebody crosses your path, sometime an opportunity comes your way, God will begin to what? Work in various ways, and he will begin to open up avenues, and then he'll send people across your path to help you to make what? That vision, whatever plan he's given you, reality. So the excitement, the motivation, and the quickening of the thoughts that God plants into you comes by meditation and comes by praising God for the most part. Now, so I want you to realize that before faith can really become alive in the area of prosperity and healing, there are some basic things that you really want to master and know real well about God's disposition toward you prospering, God's disposition toward you being healed, and how God feels about you being blessed or receiving whatever mercies that he has provided. All right, so this is the scripture that I felt like will form a foundation. If you can get this, I think that developing faith for healing, developing faith for you to keep your healing, developing faith for you to prosper, all of that will become secondhand. All right, so I want you to read the scripture with me, Psalms 145, verse 8 and 9. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger, and of great mercy. The Lord is gracious. Okay. Gracious simply means that God is disposed to showing favors. God really longs and yearns to bless us, to show favor, to do things for us that we are not able to do for ourselves. And the scripture says that Jesus was full of grace and truth. He's full of grace. Okay, so the Lord is gracious and full of compassion. You know, that kind of removes any doubt as to whether God is willing, whether God wants you to be blessed, whether God wants you to have. Jesus said that I am come that you might what? Have. Everybody said that Jesus came that we might have. Not that we might not have. If Jesus didn't want us to have, if God didn't want us to have, you know, all he would have had to done is not send Jesus. If God hadn't been willing to give up his son so that his son could become the propitiation for our sins, then all of the mercies that we enjoy, healing, prosperity, blessings, all of the blessings, all of those things would have been withheld, because it wouldn't have been a way for God to pour out these blessings upon us legally, because all of us had what? Sinned and come short of the glory of God. So Jesus had to bear our sins, and he had to become willing even before he came down here in the form of a servant. He had to agree to become the Lamb of God before he even became man. And it was because of Jesus' willingness to become sin and to take the responsibility of mankind's transgressions and bear them, pay the price for them, and to become man's merciful and compassionate high priest on an ongoing basis. See, grace is the sum total. All right, grace is the sum total of all that God has done for us through Christ. Amen. All of his mercy, all of his goodness, all of his kindness, all of the provision that Christ made, amen, is the sum total of all that God has done for us. All right, now it also includes everything that God is doing for us today through the Holy Spirit. All right, now how many remember when David penned the 23rd Psalms? How many remember that passage that a shepherd had to be right in the presence of those what? Sheep. Mm-hmm. Is that right? Mm-hmm. Okay, what did the shepherd have to do?
Has to feed the sheep.
All right, he had to be what, personally? Amidst them, right? He had to be on the scene, in person, naturally, physically. Sister Pearl said that he had to what, feed them. All right, what else the shepherd have to do to sheep?
Protect them.
Protect them.
All right, why did he have to be a protector?
So they wouldn't get harmed.
Get harmed by what?
Different animals.
All right, so there are a lot of wild
people and things.
All right, and people, human beasts. All right. Okay, shepherd had to also do other things like what?
Feed them.
Okay, that's great.
Tend to their wounds.
Okay, now how? Okay, tend to their wounds and cuts and bruises. What else?
I said groom them.
A groom, okay. All right, what else the shepherd had to do? He had to lead them, right? Guide them. Because sheep can't even find green pasture by themselves.
Amen.
It can be right up in front of the church there. They wouldn't have a clue as to how to get up there. Kind of reminds you of some of us. Don't throw nothing up here. Now, the point I'm making is that the shepherd, he is involved with every aspect of the sheep's survival. And God is also involved with every aspect of our need. And there's no way God can come down, you know, like Jesus, when he was here on the earth, he was limited as to how much he could do. Because he only could minister to people in the, what, area, right, where he was. So that was one of the reasons why Jesus had to, it was better for him to go away, to ascend, and send back the Holy Spirit, so that the Holy Spirit could be Jesus here on earth, and the Holy Spirit could do everything that a human shepherd had to do for the natural sheep right in their midst, right in their presence. So the Holy Spirit does, how many know the Holy Spirit comforts you?
Yes.
The Holy Spirit is a healer.
Yes. Yeah.
That's one of the reasons why we are filled with the Holy Spirit when it comes to physically. So the Holy Spirit makes life. I mean, there's a much higher degree of life operating in your spirit to heal you than it were before you were filled with the Holy Spirit. One of the main functions of the Holy Spirit is to make life. You know, sometimes we don't eat right, we don't exercise, and yet we feel okay.
Yeah.
Amen, because there's life in the Word. And I know a whole lot of people live to be 80 and 90 years old, didn't exercise. A lot of them ate whatever they wanted to eat. But a lot of them were very anointed. And when they came to church, they danced all over the place. And they praised the Lord.